We are now at the AFC East. We've already done the AFC, NFC North and South, and the NFC East as well. So if you haven't watched those videos yet, I encourage you to go watch them. They're all linked into a playlist at the end of this video. So sit back, relax, watch this video. And then, you know, also please hit that like button, subscribe button, share it with your friends, your family, people you don't like, and then start liking Shredder videos together, watch them together, or don't. I can't control you. But either way, today we're going to go over the AFC East, give all of their teams their in the AFC East their rankings on their draft class, and then give out some awards for the division. So without further ado, let's go ahead and get right into the video. The Jets started off the draft process really by trading for Aaron Rodgers. He's obviously going to be a huge help for them quickly, but they had to hit on their left tackle spot. And then they got royally screwed over by division rival New England Patriots and Pittsburgh Steelers. So, you know, it sucks for them, but it's great for my team, so I don't care. The Jets were going to take whatever tackle was available between Broderick Jones, Peter Skoronski, and Paris Johnson. Johnson went at 6, Skoronski at 11. And somehow Darnell Wright went at 10, but then Broderick Jones was traded up for by the Pittsburgh Steelers to 14 with the Patriots, and they took him. Then the Jets took Will McDonald IV at 15. Pretty rough pick in my opinion. To me, he was just not the best player, his own position even available. Much less was he the best player available on the board. And I just, you know, if you really need a tackle, why not trade back? Or Darnell Wright was already taken at 10. It wouldn't even be that bad of a pick for them to take Anton Harrison at 15. So just do that. I don't know. You know, they went a route. Maybe he can be a decent player. I had him as a back-end first-round guy at best, around pick 29. But that was as best as I got with him. So I don't get the pick. I feel like they just kind of settled. And why settle, you know? So it is what it is. But it's already done, and it's over and out. Then they got Joe Tippmann in the second round. He's a pretty tall center, but he knows how to use his size, and even being as tall as he is, it doesn't really affect his game. He's got a really good football IQ, and he just knows how to direct the offensive line, and so he understands that he is bigger, but he can use it to his strengths and knows how to play smaller but still use that big guy strength in his game. Carter Warren has great size and length, heavily sought after traits for tackles, so he was a good pick here, I think. A long-term team captain for Pitt, and you know, he knows how to use his hands, but he's not super quick with his feet. So that can be an issue sometimes, as it leads him to draw penalties to himself because he gets too far ahead of himself. His hands get a little active while his feet are lagging behind, and he gets, you know, holding penalties and all that kind of stuff. So it can be issues, but nothing that a NFL coach and NFL team can't fix. So I like Carter Warren in the fourth round for sure, and then. Pitt teammate of Carter Warren, Israel Abanaconda, had 1,800 all-purpose yards a season and led the FBS in rushing touchdowns with 20 touchdowns. So super productive, had an amazing pro day. You know, he has a great one-cut ability as well. Really fast guy. He's an urgent runner, but that is also kind of one of his weaknesses. He kind of takes off before he lets himself see the lanes develop and open up in front of him. But, you know, he can succeed in an early down spot for sure. That third down position, don't know. But I can definitely see him developing into a pretty solid back in the NFL as it is. And then Zaire Barnes, he has experience at inside and outside linebacker spots. He also has special teams production in his back pocket. That's, you know, going to help him a lot in the NFL, helps a lot of guys in the NFL when they already come in with that. He can do some coverage also. He doesn't carry much technique into his rushing ability. So I see that as a potential issue, being raw at that spot. But the ability for him to just play around in different spots on the field is going to help him a lot, and that could give him a spot on a roster in the league early. So, not a bad pickup necessarily. Jerick Bernard Converse is not really going to succeed as a corner in the NFL to me. He's too slow from side to side. He doesn't have lateral quickness at all, really, and doesn't really have very good flow in his hips. They're pretty sticky, and he just gets caught up with receivers changing directions pretty rough. He does have tons of college experience with 56 starts, and you know, he may find a spot as a deep safety in zone coverage, just trying to keep everything in front of him. That might be the best situation for him. So, you know, maybe a guy who can develop, but I don't know if he's going to be a whole lot in the NFL with his lack of athleticism at that spot. And then Zach Kuntz, he's basically Darnell Washington without the blocking and add more athleticism. He really is an elite athlete with his height and weight. You know, he's more of a receiver than a tight end, though. He doesn't have the coordination of a pass catcher, even though he is a receiver more than a tight end. So, not the best combination necessarily, but it is what it is. He is 6'7" and 255 pounds. He ran a 4.55 at 40, and so he's got athleticism. That's not the question. But he's just not exactly the football player you'd expect him to be. He did only have 15 starts in college, so maybe you can kind of give him a little break there. That's not a lot of time. And, you know, part of that's injuries. Part of that was being at Penn State, I believe, to begin with, and, you know, moving around to Old Dominion after that. So I do like his athleticism. Maybe he can develop after he just takes a little time to work on his craft, but not a terrible pick in terms of value. He might be a fine player in the NFL with some time. So with that said, that is the Jets draft class, and we are going to give them a B. I don't mind a lot of their picks. Tippmann, Warren, Abanaconda, and then Kuntz even. Zaire Barnes is okay as well, but I don't mind any of those. Just they really missed in the first round. I mean, at that point, just take Anton Harrison. And if not that, trade back. Surely somebody wants to come up to pick 15. I don't see that as a possible outcome. Even if it's just trading back four or five spots, I don't see the value there. So they get a B from me. Moving on to the New England Patriots. They screwed over the up-and-coming division rival, as I've already said, and then picked 77 times in this draft. So I'm not going to go over every pick they have. It's just too much to do. But their draft started with Christian Gonzalez. They were able to trade back to pick 17 and get him, and he was the second-best corner in the draft, if not the best. Definitely has the highest upside, and thanks to Washington for that. They took Emmanuel Forbes, who I don't think most people had as a first-round player. Gonzalez is raw, but man, I mean, he feels like a Patriot, and they do have a pretty solid track record in developing corners, so I can trust them to do something with him. You know, I don't think anybody in this draft necessarily has a better ceiling than Christian Gonzalez. I feel like that is a good spot for him to go in New England. But, you know, some people cite that he has a lack of aggression in his game that makes him fall. Maybe, you know, he just doesn't seem to care as much or something like that. But I think he'll be fine in New England. I think they can straighten him out, and this is going to be a good pick, in my opinion. I just think he pans out in New England. It looks like it will work. And then Keon White. He was one of the guys in the draft green room that was not selected night one. He did not return. I believe Brian Branch was the only guy to return. And he was kind of interesting as a prospect. He was a tight end at the start of college. Had a little bit of success in his redshirt freshman season. Then he moved to defense and had an elite year with 19 tackles for loss and 3.5 sacks in 2019 at Old Dominion, actually. And then this past year, he ended up, not this past year, it was I think year before, transferring to Georgia Tech. And he had 14 tackles for loss and 7.5 sacks. So, highly productive player. He's got the production you want, and he is a big guy. He is a big edge rusher, and he can find himself some success quickly in the NFL. And he's another player. I really see New England being a good spot for him. So, not a bad pick there. Then, Marty Mapu. Would it be a draft without New England getting somebody who didn't go to an FBS school early? Sure, not as early as they've done before with Kyle Duggar and Cole Strange, but still, you know, he was more of a safety in college, but he's going to have to play the linebacker position in the league if he wants to find success, which means he's going to have to put some weight on. He's a little bit slender to play linebacker right now, but he's a very willing hitter, and he knows his strengths. He knows how to roam the box, and, you know, he tries to use his strength. He knows what they are, and he just tries to use them to his advantage. He can find a real role in the NFL. I see him as a weak side linebacker sooner rather than later, honestly. So I think he'll be fine in the NFL as long as he can continue. But that is not a horrible pick at the 76th overall pick. And then moving on, Jake Andrews, they only drafted him because David Andrews, just kidding. He is an elite athlete, but only played center this last year. He did earn first-team all-conference in the Sun Belt as a center, so that's something to look at. I mean, with only 1 year under his belt at the center position. But, you know, he has strong hands, really good overall strength. He knows how to use his body to generate more strength than usual. But he also has tons of experience, over 3,000 snaps and 37 starts across the offensive line. He needs to be quicker since he's already lacking some length. He's got stubby arms. He's just not the most tall guy either. Just he's got to be quicker to get to his spots before the defense does. But he could be a guy who sits around for maybe a year or so and then gets some spot snaps as well, but then develops later to a good starter. And then skipping around some, Kayshon Boutte, was a great receiver the year Jamar Chase sat out. He led LSU with over 700 yards. However, 308 of those yards were an SEC record game against Ole Miss. So almost half the yards came in one game. Obviously, he has some big game capabilities. When he's hot, he's hot. But he has a lack of ball skills, which is pretty concerning. I think he could be fine in the league with some work, but I don't know if he fits on this New England roster. Maybe he gets a training camp spot somewhere else after a little while, but I just don't see him in New England necessarily for that long. However, that doesn't mean he will not have an NFL career. And then DeMario Douglas, really good speed, really good quickness, but he is smaller, quite a bit smaller. And the problem with him is he doesn't really have very good route running for a guy his size. Typically, that's one thing you're going to have in these smaller guys. They're going to kind of just know how to get themselves open with their quickness and their speed. But he doesn't really do that. He has muff punt history, so he needs to work on that. But he could become a return man. And he's a good depth piece in the league if he can get his route running down. And, you know, he's got the quickness and the traits to be a good route runner and wide receiver in the NFL. He just has to put it together. So, not a bad one. And then Isaiah Bolden, he has great measurables. He fits into a press man corner role very well from his traits. But he really just doesn't have the ball production you'd want from a guy who plays that role. And, you know, he's up there in personal in their space, but just doesn't get the production on the ball. So, something you got to look for on him. But he does have a experience as return man as well, so that could help him find a spot in the league early. That special teams props always helps guys find their role in the NFL. And then, so that is the rest of the New England draft. I mean, they got a punter and they got a kicker in the fourth round. That's always semi-questionable. No matter how good they are, you got to just, I mean, have a little pause in there. But, you know, it is what it is. They took them, they got them, and that gives me A-minus grade. I love the fact that they were able to get Christian Gonzalez at the 17th overall pick, a really good steal and value pick there. Keon White is another good value. And then they just got some solid players down the board. Nothing too bad there. That gives them an A-minus. And we will move on to Buffalo. Buffalo had a good draft and made a shocking pick early on. Dalton Kincaid is a good player. The pick doesn't make tons and tons of sense, though, when you think they have a guy who is basically just like him in Dawson Knox. They have some dire needs in the run game and on defense, and I just don't really see how he fits either of those. I mean, you know, he's a good player, and maybe you don't always have to draft for your needs. Maybe it's just best player available to you, but I was thinking about this, and I was looking at some of the things about him, and I found that he spent over 50% of his time in the slot at Utah. Maybe Bills could be working on some new form of offense here with two tight ends on the field, but not on either side of the line, or on a heavy side or anything like that. Maybe they want to put Dalton Kincaid in the slot and Diggs and Davis on the outside receiver positions and then have Dawson Knox in your traditional tight end role and then just kind of go crazy. I mean, he's a big guy. He's a receiver. He's hardly a tight end. He's almost just a receiver, but just in a tight end's body. I mean, I don't know. Maybe they wanted a wide receiver in Buffalo. Maybe they wanted a Quentin Johnston or a Jordan Addison, but they were all gone. So they got what they could get, and the best wide receiver on the board was Dalton Kincaid. So, you know, they made ends meet, I guess, in one way or another. He's a great player. I just, you know, maybe the fit's not there, but that doesn't mean he's not a good player. He is a very good player. And then Osiris Torrence, one of my favorite picks in the entire draft. Best player at his position of the whole draft, in my opinion. And he's just a massive beast at the guard position. A really good prospect who fits in Buffalo really well. Gives a start to the wall that they're trying to build for Josh Allen. I mean, for a deep passing scheme, he's not as quick, but if you can just stand there and hold people in place and make a giant wall where it gives Josh Allen 5 minutes to throw a one pass, I mean, what else can you ask for? I just, you know, he fits that, and then he can be a mauler in the run game whenever they decide to start running the ball in Buffalo as well. So, a really good pick, in my opinion, there. And then in their third round, they got Dorian Williams, an athletic linebacker, had over 130 tackles last season, and 8.5 tackles for loss with a team-leading 5 sacks from the linebacker spot. He also has good coverage ability. I mean, he's kind of just a do-it-all guy. He's really good at finding the ball carrier, and he is really good at wrapping up the defenders, the ball carriers as well. Just a really solid player. Could easily be the day one athletic linebacker starter next to Matt Milano with the loss of Tremaine Edmonds. So not a bad pick at all. Justin Shorter, he has a really huge catch radius and very good hands. Make his way in the league early with just as a deep threat. You have to wonder why Buffalo got him. I don't know. Maybe they want to throw the ball far down the field with their really strong quarterback or something. But he's a massive wide receiver. He's 6'4", 230 pounds. He doesn't have the best release, and he kind of gets lost in some press man, which is interesting as big as he is. But, I mean, as long as he can get over the top, and if he gets down the field at all, if he can get you to turn around, he might just grab it over your head and you won't even know about it. So that could keep him in the NFL, just how big he is and how he knows how to use his size against corners. And then Nick Broeker, tons of starts, tons of snaps at Ole Miss. Finishes his blocks, works through the whistle super well, always plays. For a late round guy, he should have some success in the league pretty quick. Not quite as lengthy. And needs to find himself in his pass blocking game for sure, but he could be a dirty run blocker, and his motor really will help him stay in the NFL for a long time, even as a seventh round pick. And then Alex Austin, he is a zone corner. He struggles in man coverage. You know, he is above average ball production though over the last two seasons, which is interesting being a zone guy. But you know, he just knows where the football is and he knows how to get there. So that's fine. He, you know, knows how to find the route combinations and how they're going to come off the line. He sees the field well as a corner, which is something that is not a bad thing for a guy playing in zone, maybe farther back down the field. He isn't much of a willing tackler, though, but what's interesting about that is he's pretty good at run support. Maybe he, you know, won't just lay into a guy, but he at least will put his body there and, you know, try to stop something or at least trip him up. So he gets involved at least. For a seventh-round pick, can you ask for much more? With that said, the Buffalo Bills, a good draft. I think maybe one of the better ones in the league, possibly. So that gives them an A, in my opinion. Very solid draft. Some really quality players. Maybe not at the most needed positions, but just quality in general. And then, finally, Miami. They had a ridiculously long amount of draft capital, didn't they? You know, I can't even think I could get through all these picks. I don't know. Either way, Cam Smith, really solid pickup. He's a very physical corner, really good instincts on the defensive side of the football. You know, he's a physical corner, and I love this situation for him. He goes into a room with Xavier Howard and Jalen Ramsey where he can sit back, learn from these guys, get some reps as the CB3 probably. I mean, but that's his, I mean, at best, and that's not saying anything bad about Cam Smith. He's just in a very good corner room right now. You know, I really do think this is a good pick for him, and he can just wait, grow, and just learn from these really good corners currently in the league. So, not a bad pick there. And then Devon Achain, he had over 1,100 yards, contributed as a wide receiver on the team as well. He's a blazing runner. He participated in Texas A&M's track team. I mean, this guy, he also knows how to run people over. That's something you don't tend to get out of these really fast guys. They don't tend to like to just run over guys because they think they can just run around them and not have to worry about them. But no, not Devon Achain. He will do whatever he needs to get down the field. You know, that's something I really like to see. He has a little tendency to wait a long time for development of the offensive line and some gaps, but that's not the best thing as it kind of gets the defense the ability to catch him in the backfield. But, you know, he seems like he's just going to be a really successful guy in the league one day. Not the biggest guy, but he plays way bigger than he is. So a good pick there, in my opinion. And then Elijah Higgins from Stanford. You know, he's 6'3", almost 240 pounds. He's a big slot receiver type. He's much more of the possession wide receiver than a deep threat, unlike Shorter from the Bills. And he has really good routes for a guy who may even become a tight end in the NFL. He doesn't have the best catch radius for a guy his size and has quite a few drop problems, in my opinion. But, I mean, nothing that he can't work on and then maybe move over to the tight end spot in a few short years after he maybe gets a little more weight on him. And then, finally, Ryan Hayes. He was a two-year starter for the award-winning Michigan offensive line, but he likely will have to move to a guard spot to stay in the NFL. The problem with that is he kind of is weird. He's too tall to be a guard and plays too up high to be a guard, but he doesn't really have the length to be a tackle, so he's kind of just a tweener and in not a good way. You know, he's a guy who I probably expect to be in the spring league sooner rather than later, sadly for him. So Miami has all those terribly long, extensive draft picks, so we're going to have to give them a B+ because they just didn't have enough in this draft. I mean, they did good for what they had. Don't get me wrong. Cam Smith, A-Chain, and Higgins are fine players, but Hayes is okay. But nothing bad here. I just, you know, they're not going to win this draft with having only 4 picks, especially not a first rounder. So that leaves us with our AFC East awards. So for the best pick, I had to put Osiris Torrance. I mean, was the best player in his position, was a first-round player, in my opinion. It wasn't even the first guard taken. I think that was a mistake by other teams, and I think they'll regret that in the coming years. But, yeah, Osiris Torrance, just a really good pick, in my opinion. The worst pick was Will McDonald, the 4th. I like Will McDonald as a player, but just a horrible spot to take him, really. I think they just settled on what was on the board. I mean, and I don't know what they thought. To me, he wasn't the best player available his position. He wasn't the best player available on the board. He wasn't their biggest need. This pick doesn't make a whole lot of sense to me, and I just don't see why you make it. The biggest shock was Christian Gonzalez to the Patriots, and it's not because he fell to the Patriots. I mocked him there at 14. It was because a team picked a corner before him that was Emmanuel Forbes and not Christian Gonzalez. So it was more the fact that he was here. but then again, it was Washington, so what can I expect? And finally, the least shocking was Patriots drafting beyond the FBS early. Do I need to say anything else? No. Who won? The Bills. Great draft for Buffalo. I mean, getting Kincaid, as good of a player he is, and then Osiris Torrance, and then also Dorian Williams. Two big needs right there in Torrance and Williams, and just really good picks, in my opinion. So, the Bills won this division. But with that said, that will be all for this video. Thank you guys for watching. I really do appreciate it. Please keep the love coming. Keep the likes coming. Keep the subscribers coming. You know, I'm trying to get this as big as I can. So that takes you guys. And I really appreciate what I've gotten so far. So thank you guys for watching, and peace.